Good afternoon, Georgetown Church of God family and anyone else who happens to join us. I wanted to come on today and do the Sunday school lesson, and I wanted to pre-record it today because I have been sick actually for the last couple of days. It's not the virus, coronavirus, but I've had some type of stomach bug or something that's evidently I've called or something. So I'm feeling better, but while I was feeling a little bit better, I decided to go ahead and try to pre-record this. I'm going to kind of do it a little bit faster today, a little bit different way, so that I don't record so much that it may not upload. The longer a video is, sometimes it takes forever to upload, and sometimes it won't upload at all. So if this seems like it's moving around a little bit faster, I apologize, but we're going to go ahead and get into our Sunday school lesson, which will be for tomorrow, should we have been in church, for April the 19th. And let me just say that we do love you all. We miss you all. We're still praying for you. We're hoping that this is going to be over soon, that we'll be able to have Sunday school again like normal. But until then, we want to keep reaching out and doing what we can to let you know we're here. We're praying for you. We're studying. We're reading. We're preparing our lessons and our sermons and our videos, our kids and youth too, doing all, and our music, doing all we can to reach out to you. Let me go ahead and say this if I don't forget to mention at the end. Be sure to join us in the morning for Sunday morning worship. Music will either be at 10:30 or 10:45, and then Pastor Morgan's message. He'll be preaching at 11 tomorrow morning. Then tomorrow night at 6 o'clock, he will be live preaching. Actually, he's got a special service, let me get that right, in mind, that he's been planning and working on. So you'll have some special things to see tomorrow night. So I don't want to say much more than that to give away what he's doing, but don't forget about tomorrow night at 6 as well. That being said, I know we have many needs. Let's just keep these needs in our prayer time that we have throughout the day. Remember those that we've been getting phone trees about. If you'll continue to still pray for me, I'd appreciate it. But we're going to go on into our lesson and just keep praying for our church and our nation and our president as well, and that we can get through this just as fast as we can. The lesson is the End Times Prophetic Panorama, which means it gives us a panoramic view of this final vision that Daniel is going to receive. And it's going to be, you know, regarding the Jews and also regarding futuristic events that have not even taken place yet for us. And it says, through faith in Christ, believers can stand courageously for him in perilous times. And we are living in some times like that right now with what we're going through with this virus. But we have to remain faithful. That's going to be a part of our lesson we're going to talk about. The overview of the lesson says, this lesson mentions many of the same historical events covered in previous lessons. In reading Daniel 10 through 12, it is important to note how the Jews' lives and history were affected by foreign kingdoms. These chapters dig even deeper into the wars between the Seleucid or Syrian kingdom and the Ptolemaic or Egyptian kingdom, and the consequences of this for the post-captivity Jews living in Judea and Jerusalem. As this lesson shows, this history, which was predictive prophecy at the time it was written, reveals that God fights for his people and works for their good in spite of those who do evil. This is a fact about God well worth remembering by every Christian. And we do know the Lord fights for us. The outline of the lesson in three parts, as always, is the first part is strengthened to understand the vision, talking about Daniel being strengthened. The second part is God's people shine in darkness. And the third part is the time of the end. And our golden text is Daniel 12 and 2. And it says, many of them that sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life and some to shame and everlasting contempt. And as we begin our lesson, it says that the book of Daniel tells of the courage of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who were delivered from a fiery furnace by God. It also tells of the courage of Daniel, who was delivered by God from a den of lions. The last chapter of Daniel describes perilous times that were foretold, describes a final vision, excuse me, that foretold perilous times, sorry about this, I get my camera right, for God's people. These perilous times would require faith and courage of God's people to remain faithful to him. However, the assurance was and is that God will reward his faithful people. And he will reward us if we will remain faithful. The first verses is Daniel 10, 1 through 11. And this says, in the third year of Cyrus, king of Persia, a message was revealed to Daniel, whose name was called Belteshazzar. The message was true, but the appointed time was long. And he understood the message and had understanding of the vision. In those days, I, Daniel, was mourning 3 full weeks. I ate no pleasant food, no meat or wine came into my mouth, nor did I anoint myself at all, till 3 whole weeks were fulfilled. Now the 24th day of the first month, as I was by the side of the great river, that is the Tigris, I lifted up my eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose waist was girded with gold of Uphaz. His body was like beryl, his face like the appearance of lightning, his eyes like torches of fire, his arms and feet like burnished bronze in color, and the sound of his words like the voice of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men who were with me did not see the vision, but a great terror fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves. Therefore I was left alone when I saw this great vision, and no strength remained in me, for my vigor was turned to frailty in me, and I retained no strength. Yet I heard the sound of his words, and while I heard the sound of his words, I was in a deep sleep on my face, with my face to the ground. Suddenly a hand touched me, which made me tremble on my knees and on the palms of my hands. And he said to me, O Daniel, man greatly beloved, understand the words that I speak to you, and stand upright, for I have now been sent to you. While he was speaking this word to me, I stood trembling. So this is a fourth and final vision given to Daniel by God. It provides further details of events described in earlier visions concerning future conflicts that would affect the Jews. Daniel had great concern for his people, the Jews, and so he mourned, fasted, and prayed on their behalf for 3 weeks. Then Daniel had a vision of a man standing by the Tigris River. It is apparent the man in Daniel's vision, verses 4 through 9, was more than a mere man. Most think this was the angel Gabriel. This man was not visible to some men who were with Daniel on this occasion, but they were stricken with terror and ran away, leaving Daniel alone. Daniel was so overwhelmed by this vision, he fell to the ground in a trance-like state, described by Daniel as a deep sleep. The man, a messenger of God, raised Daniel to his hands and knees, enabled him to stand, and exhorted him to hear the message that he had for him. And here I'm going to go on to the next part, and because they go together, and the next part is Daniel 10, 12 through the rest of Daniel, and then it picks up at 11 and 1. And I'm not going to read those scriptures because that is a lot of scriptures that take up a lot of time. So if you want to go back and read Daniel 10, 12 through 21, and then it picks up at 11 and 1. But I'm going to give you a synopsis of what those verses mean. It says, the man, the messenger of the Lord to Daniel, provided him with information about what had been happening in the spiritual realm during the 21 days that Daniel was praying. So this man that appeared to Daniel in the vision is now picking up in these verses telling him what's been happening because Daniel had been praying. And it says, during the 21 days that he was praying, the man said that Daniel's prayers was heard the very first day of his praying. And the man had come to answer his prayer. He said that they heard his prayer and was on his way to answer his prayer, but his arrival had been delayed because he was in battle for 21 days with the prince of the kingdom of Persia. He was not able to free himself from this battle until the angel Michael came to help him. Then he came to give Daniel understanding of what would befall the Jews in the latter days. Bible scholars generally accept that these verses are a description of a battle in the spiritual realm between Gabriel and an evil angel representing the kingdom of Persia. Gabriel was not able to gain the victory over this evil angel until Michael came to help him, freeing him to take to Daniel the answer to his prayer. And it says that Daniel was again so overwhelmed by the revelation being made known to him that he fell down to the ground and could not speak. Then the man touched Daniel's lips, and he was made able to speak, only to say that his strength was gone. In response to Daniel, the man strengthened him, assured him of God's love for him, and told him not to be afraid. And he spoke peace to him and strengthened him. After this, the man said that he had come to show him that what was noted in the scripture of truth, verse 21, then he would return to help Michael in the continuing spiritual battle with the prince of Persia and the prince of Greece. And here in my notes, I wrote that, you know, God's will is going to be done in our lives and on this earth. And just, you know, and before I say that I wanted to mention here that I had wrote, when we pray, as Daniel had prayed, and the answer doesn't come right away, it doesn't mean that the answer's not coming. Sometimes our answer may be delayed, But what this shows us is that what we don't know is that warfare is being done on our behalf, that our answers can come to us, that our prayers can be answered. And we don't know what warfare is being done when we've prayed for something and it seems like it takes forever. We don't think about the fact that spiritual warfare is going on our behalf so that our answer can come. Because like he says, he heard his prayer on day one when he prayed it, and he was coming to send him that answer, but he was delayed in helping to battle spiritual warfare. So don't give up praying just because you don't get your answer right away. Know that battle is being done on your behalf so that the answer can be delivered in the time that the Lord would have it. And you know, that means that God's will is going to be done in our lives. He will answer our prayers. And just as this virus has some type of purpose, and we don't really understand what that is, it can be used for good. And you know, just like our churches are being forced to film right now, some that have never filmed before are reaching people that they may have never reached before. And once the purpose of this virus is fulfilled, it will be over with. You know, the Lord spoke that to our pastor just a few weeks ago. So don't lose hope in the prayers that you're praying. Hold on and keep praying, because just like with Daniel, his answer was delayed, but it still came. Just because an answer to our prayer or prayers seems to be delayed, it doesn't mean that it isn't coming, and that it may not come in the way, sometimes it doesn't come the way we think it will, but it doesn't mean that it's not going to come. So keep holding on. It says the book of Daniel is very much about the sovereignty of God, that God is sovereign. It means that he has supreme authority over all things to bring human history to the conclusion that he wills it to be. If we lose sight of this fact, we may become discouraged by world events like what we're going through now. That would cause us to think that the truth is forever on the scaffold and that hate is forever on the throne. And we know that's not true. As believers in Christ living in this last age before Christ comes again, we must be spiritually alert and pray and never forget that God's kingdom will come and ultimately his will shall be done. In part two, it talks about that God's people will shine in darkness. And this is found in Daniel 11, 2 through 35. And those scriptures here, again, I'm not going to read these. Actually, I went and was supposed to have read the others and not read these, but I'm not going to read this one either, because this is the section that is, I had that mixed up. This is the section that is great as far as verse wise to try to get fitted in here. But if you'll go back and read Daniel 11, 2 through 35, I'm going to read you here what the description of what's going on here is. It says, here is the message that the man presumed to be the angel Gabriel gave to Daniel, giving him additional understanding of the scripture or visions already given to him. The prophecies in these verses foretold events that would have profound effects on the post-captivity Jews living in Judea and Jerusalem between 530 and 142 BC. Keep in mind that the events foretold here occurred after Daniel's lifetime. So these events, you know, were futuristic. Here's the prophecy Gabriel gave to Daniel. Verse 2 is about a succession of Persian rulers between 536 and 480 BC. Then was foretold that the Greek empire of Alexander the Great would be divided among four of his top generals, making four kingdoms from one. After this, there would be continuing war between two of these kingdoms, the Ptolemaic Greek kingdom of Egypt and the Seleucid Greek kingdom of Syria. During most of this time, the Jews in Judea were under the benevolent rule of the Ptolemies in Egypt. However, eventually the Seleucid ruler Antiochus Epiphanes brought Egypt under his control, and the Jews in Judea came under the cruel rule of Antiochus. Returning from Egypt, he attacked Jerusalem, killed 80,000 Jews, took 40,000 as his own slaves, and sold another 40,000 into slavery and desecrated the temple. There were four eras of Jewish history between the captivity and the birth of Jesus Christ. The Persians, we're going to skip on down from those, but it says that Judea, in the end, the Jewish fighters, the Maccabees, opposed their Syrian rulers until 142 BC, when the Jews in Judea regained their independence. Finally, the Roman era began when the Jews came under Roman rule in 63 BC. I didn't want to read all of those parts there because it does take up a good bit of our time. But, you know, what this long section of verses, you know, really shows us is that the Jews had been in constant battle and would continue to be in battle in the future to defend their homeland. They were constantly in battle against these empires, and that their deliverance wouldn't come until the appointed time that God had set up for it to come. And that's just like us here on earth. We have battles to fight because we have an enemy to fight. And as long as we're here on earth, the devil is going to fight us. And he's not going to let up until the Lord, you know, until the Lord takes us out of here, either through the rapture or by the grave. Either way, God has appointed that time, not us. So we have to keep on fighting and pressing on until our time of escape comes, just as the Jews did. We have to keep on remaining faithful. And that's going to be the part that we're going to next, is the last, it talks about how the faithful are going to be outstanding. And this is found in verses 11, 30, chapter 36 through 12, 4. And again, I knew that was going to happen the way I had my phone was set up. Sorry about that. But again, I'm just going to have you go through and read these verses on your own, because I could say that, here we go again. Yeah, just bear with me as we're having to deal with our time here. But chapter 11, 36 through 12 and 4, it says that Bible scholars have varying opinions about the correct interpretation of Daniel 36 through 45. Some think these verses are descriptive of Antiochus Epiphanes, who cruelly persecuted the Jews. Others speculate that this was a prophecy about the Muslims taking possession of the Holy Land, formerly the land of Israel, in the 7th century of the Christian era, blotting out Christianity in much of the Southwest Asia, North Africa, and the Middle East. However, among evangelical Christians, the most popular opinion is that these verses refer to the rise of the Antichrist, the archenemy of Christ, and the church at the end of the age. Again, this is Daniel 11, verses 36 through 45, and then 12 and 4. Actually, 12, 1 through 4. And if you'll go back and read that before this section, that'll help you. Assuming this prophecy is about the Antichrist, it concludes with these encouraging words: "Yet he shall come to his end, and no one will help him." The Antichrist, like all the enemies of God and Christ, is doomed to defeat and everlasting condemnation. Christ and his kingdom and church will be victorious over all the forces of evil, and of his kingdom there will be no end. The first four verses of Daniel 12 tell of a time of trouble for the Jews, such as never was since there was a nation. During this time, Michael, the guardian angel of the Jews, will stand in their defense, and they shall be delivered, everyone who is written in the book of life. Verse 2 tells of the resurrection of the dead, some to everlasting life, some to shame, and some to everlasting contempt. Also, those who are wise, those who love and live for God, shall shine like the brightness of the firmament. And here it says that in the end, God will deliver his people. And in times of attack and persecution, such as these scriptures reveal, is when God's people often shine the most. Just think of what we are going through right now. In this time of tragedy and uncertainty and hardship for so many, still the gospel is being preached. People are turning to us as Christians for prayer and encouragement. And when, just like the tornado struck the other day on Monday, communities have jumped in and they're having makeshift soup kitchens. They're practicing the social distancing and the rules they have to, but that's not stopped them. They've gotten in there and they've set up soup kitchens. They've set up donations and money to help these victims. So no matter what adversity, trouble, sickness, or tragedy that we go through, the Lord helps us to shine because we reflect him and his light, and he gives us the strength to shine for him. And I'm going to go back here and pick up just so that we can understand and read this for you. I said, you know, I wasn't going to, but I feel like I need to. Chapter 11, verse 36, it says, "Then the king shall do according to his own will. He shall exalt and magnify himself above every god, shall speak blasphemies against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the wrath has been accomplished, for what has been determined shall be done. He shall regard neither the god of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall exalt himself above them all. But in their place he shall honor a god of fortresses, and a god which his fathers did not know. He shall honor with gold and silver, with precious stones and pleasant things. Thus he shall act against the strongest fortresses with a foreign god, which he shall acknowledge and advance his glory, and he shall cause them to rule over many, and divide the land for gain. At the time of the end, the king of the south shall attack him, and the king of the north shall come against him like a whirlwind, with chariots, horsemen, and with many ships. And he shall enter the countries, overwhelm them, and pass through. He shall also enter the glorious land, and many countries shall be overthrown, but these shall escape from his hand, Edom, Moab, and the prominent people of Ammon. He shall stretch out his hand against the countries, and the land of Egypt shall not escape. He shall have power over the treasures of gold and silver and over all the precious things of Egypt. Also the Libyans and Ethiopians shall follow at his heels, but news from the east and north shall trouble him. Therefore he shall go out with great fury to destroy and annihilate many. And he shall plant the tents of his palace between the seas and the glorious holy mountain. Yet he shall come to his end, and no one will help him. At that time Michael shall stand up, the great prince who stands watch over the sons of your people, and there shall be a time of trouble, such as never was since there was a nation, even to that time. And at that time your people shall be delivered, every one who was found written in the book. And many of those who sleep in the dust of the earth shall awake, some to everlasting life, some to shame and everlasting contempt. Those who are wise shall shine like the brightness of the firmament, and those who turn many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. And but you, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book until the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and the knowledge shall increase. And we know that's talking about 2 days that we're living in right now. So I'm going to reread my commentary now. In the end, God will deliver his people. And in times of attack, persecution, such as these scriptures reveal, is when God's people often shine the most. Just think of what we're going through right now. Like we said, in the time of tragedy and uncertainty and hardship that we're going through, still the gospel is being preached. And we are reaching people for Christ. And people are asking Christians, like we said, for prayer and encouragement. And like we said, Monday when the bad weather came through and the tornadoes that killed so many and tragedies, that, you know, churches are stepping up, they're shining. It's in times of adversity when the church will shine. And this is a light that the sinner doesn't have. He doesn't have the light that we have. And the world doesn't have this light that we have. Their light is dull and dim, but we in the spiritual realm are shining with the brightest light that can be imagined, because we know that our hope is not in the world, and it's God that gives us that light through him. And lastly, the third part of this lesson, and sorry, I keep hitting my camera. The third part of this lesson is Daniel 12, verses 5 through 10. And it says, "Then I, Daniel, looked, and there stood two others, one on this river bank and the other on that river bank. And one said to the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river, 'How long shall the fulfillment of these wonders be?' Then I heard the man clothed in linen who was above the waters of the river, when he held up his right hand and his left hand to heaven, and swore by him who lives forever, that it shall be for a time, times and a half a time. And when the power of the holy people has been completely shattered, all these things shall be finished. Although I heard, I did not understand. Then I said, 'My Lord, what shall be the end of these things?' And he said, 'Go your way, Daniel, for the words are closed up and sealed to the time of the end. Many shall be purified, made white, and refined, but the wicked shall do wickedly, and none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand.'" And here Daniel saw two men, one standing on each side of the Tigris River. One of them asked a man dressed in linen hovering above the waters of the river, "When these events foretold, when would they take place?" The man dressed in linen replied that it shall be for a time, times, and a half a time, meaning interpret this as meaning 3.5 years, and see it as referring to the second half of the 7 years of the great tribulation at the end of the age. However, 3.5 being half of 7, signifying perfection or completion, can also mean that something is determined for an indefinite time. Whatever it means, Daniel did not understand it, but he was assured that God is working out his redemptive plan. And as a result, as it says in verse 10, many shall be purified, made white, and refined. And here that I wrote that, I wrote that I wanted to go to the next section, so let me catch myself before I get ahead to the very end, because it kind of goes right in about talking about the God's redemptive purpose here, but how the faithfulness of the people are needed. So we're going to finish up with the last two verses. This is 11 through 13 of Daniel chapter 12. And it says, "And from the time that the daily sacrifice is taken away and the abomination of desolation is set up, there shall be 1,290 days. Blessed is he who waits and comes to the 1,335 days. But you go your way till the end, for you shall rest," talking about Daniel, "and will arise to your inheritance at the end of the days." So the man dressed in linen continued to speak to Daniel the words in the verse 11 as saying, refer to the persecution of the Jews. Many say this refers to the persecution of the Jews under Antiochus, but in a much deeper sense in the broad history of the world, they describe the times of the Antichrist. The persecution under Antiochus lasted 10 days longer than 3 years. In like manner, there will be a generally extended period at the end of this age in which events analogous to the times of Antiochus take place. Another view is that Daniel 12 and 11, Matthew 24 and 15, and Revelation chapters 11, 12, and 13 and 5 refer to the 7 years of the 70th week. Remember, we did that lesson a couple weeks ago of Daniel's prophecy, which will come at the end of this age. In this last age, God again deals with the Jewish people. There will be a temple and sacrifices. When the temple is again desecrated and an abomination set up, then the end is near. The man dressed in linen concluded his message to Daniel with the assurance that he would rest after his death and would be resurrected to his inheritance at the end of time. Daniel didn't understand all that was revealed to him about the future events. And you know, a lot of Christian preachers and teachers have come up with many different interpretive scenarios of what is going to happen in the end times and maybe what all these verses mean. However, to inherit the promises of God is not essential to understand all the details of how prophecies about future events will come to pass. And remember, I told you when we started these lessons in Daniel not to get hung up on what we didn't understand, because a lot of it can be confusing. But all we need to know is that one day we do have an inheritance that we're going to get. What is required to inherit the promises is that we remain faithful to God. In order to receive what God has for us, we have to remain faithful. And also, the book challenges us as teachers and students to remember to pray for the Jews. Their time, they still have a great time of affliction. They're still not out of this world where they have, you know, been completely redeemed and where they're not having to face so much. They're still going through an awful time of persecution. And there is much in the book of Daniel about the persecution of the Jews. This lesson provides an excellent opportunity for us to remember to pray for the Jews. Antisemitism, which is hatred toward the Jews, is prevalent in many places around the world. They're still hated today. So we are to pray for the Jews, pray for Israel, and pray for the peace of Jerusalem. We are to stand with Israel. We are to pray for the Jews because these are God's chosen people. And here I wrote that what is going to get us through until the end is faithfulness. If we remain faithful, even in these tough times that are testing our faith, and if we'll remain faithful, the Lord is going to redeem us to everlasting life of joy, peace, and rest. And we will see our inheritance too, just as was promised with Daniel. You know, Daniel was a faithful man, a devout servant of God. We've learned a lot about Daniel over the last few weeks. And he was chosen to interpret dreams and visions, and who was also visited by Gabriel and had visions revealed unto him for the present time he was in and for the future, and even visions that we are awaiting now to be fulfilled. And God, too, can use you in the same way that he used Daniel in ways that's even greater. The key is that Jesus has to be in our heart first. He has to be Lord and Savior. He must be first in our lives, and nothing or no one can be above him. And we must read his word and pray, but we must also be willing to be faithful and obey what he tells us to do. You know, there's many ministries that could have done even greater works through Christ that we've never even imagined, but they've never come into fruition. They never happened because somebody was not obedient and was not faithful. And so, you know, and we have to think sometimes, how many people are we not reaching? How many people are missing out on knowing the Lord and how good he really is because perhaps we have chosen to be silent? Perhaps we have chosen to be unfaithful and disobedient. So we need to be like Daniel. We need to be faithful and steadfast, and don't let that be us. Don't let us be disobedient and unfaithful. So I hope that I have said something to you today that has made sense. I feel like I have been all over the place with this lesson, but I hope that I've said something to help you today. And like I said, please join us tomorrow, 10:30 for our worship, or either 10:45 and then 11 for our morning service. And tomorrow night at 6, we'll have a special service planned. Don't miss it. We love you all. Remember, in this time, if you need us, we're here for you. We're praying for you. We love you. And we are praying so soon that we'll be able to see you all very soon. We love you all. We hope you have a great weekend. I hope you have enjoyed this lesson. And God bless you. We love you all. Mm-hmm.